When we want to say whether something's good or not, it's not so obvious. And this unit is all about evaluation. Ah, well, it's a lovely day here in Tari. I'm looking out the window again. But how do we know it's a lovely day? I won't turn the camera around to show you because I'll probably never get it pointing back again. But I can tell you the sun's shining, it's a blue sky. I could go and measure the temperature. It's probably not that warm because it's not early in the year. But there's a number of metrics or measures I could use. Or perhaps I should go out and talk to people and see, if there's people sitting out and saying how lovely it is or whether they're all huddled inside. Now, for me, this sunny day seems like a good day. But last week, it was the Tari Wave Classic, and there was people windsurfing. The best day for them was not a sunny day. It was actually quite a dull day, quite a cold day, but it was the day with the best wind. They didn't care about the sun, they cared about the wind. So if I'd asked them, I might have gotten a very different answer than if I'd asked a different visitor to the island, or if you'd asked me about it. Evaluation's absolutely crucial to knowing whether something's right. But, the methods of it are important, they're important to do, but they tend to be a bit boring to talk about, to be honest, because you end up with long lists of things to check. When you're looking at an actual system, though, it becomes more interesting again, but it's not so interesting to talk about. What I want to do is talk more about the sort of the broader issues about how you choose what kind of evaluation to do and some of the issues that surround it. And it can be almost a conflict between people with an HCI. It's between those who are more quantitative. So when I was talking about the sunny day, I could go and measure the temperature, I could measure the wind speed if I was a surfer, a whole lot of numbers about it. As opposed to those who want to take a more qualitative approach. So instead of measuring the temperature, those are people who want to talk to people to find out more about what it means to be a good day. We could do the same for interface. I can look at a phone and say, okay, how long does it take me to make a phone call? Or I could ask somebody whether they're happy with it. What does the phone make them feel about? Different kinds of questions to ask. You can also, you might ask those questions, and you can ask this in both qualitative and quantitative way in a sealed setting. You might take somebody into a room, give them perhaps a new interface to play with. So you might, so take the computer, give them a set of tasks to do and see how long they take to do it. Or what you might do is go out and watch people in their real lives using some piece of, it might be existing software, it might be new software, or just actually observing how they do things. There's a bit of overlap here, I should have mentioned at the beginning, between evaluation techniques and empirical studies. And you might do empirical studies very, very early on, and they share a lot of features with evaluation. And they're much more likely to be wild studies. And there is advantages to each. In a laboratory situation, when you've brought people in, you can control what they're doing. You can guide them in particular ways. However, that tends to make it both more sort of, should say, robust that you know what's going on, but less about the real situation. In the real world, it's what people often call ecologically valid. It's about what they really are up to. But as it is much less controlled, harder to measure, all sorts of things. Very often, it's rarer to find more quantitative in the wild setting, but you can find both. You can both go out and perhaps do a measure of people outside. You might, go out on a sunny day and see how many people are smiling. Count the number of smiling people each day and use that as your measure. A very quantitative measure that's in the wild. More often, you might in the wild just go and ask people and some more qualitative things. Similarly, in the lab, you might do a quantitative thing, some sort of measurement, or you might ask something more qualitative, more open-ended. Also, you might do away with the users entirely. So you might have users there doing it, or you might actually use what's called an expert evaluation method or an analytic method of evaluation. By having a structured set of questions, somebody who's got a bit of expertise, a bit of knowledge, can often have a very good estimate of whether something's really likely to work or not. So you can have that sort of like expert-based or analytic-based evaluation method, or you can have something where you get real users in. Most people, I think, would say that in the end, you do want to see some real users there. You can't do it all by expert methods, but often the expert methods are cheaper and quicker to do early on in the design process. So usually both are needed. And in fact, that's the general message I think I'd like to give you about this, that in general, it's the combination of different kinds of methods which tend to be most powerful. Sometimes at different stages, you might do expert evaluation or analytic evaluation early, more with real users later, although probably you want to see some users at all stages. Particularly quantitative and qualitative methods, which are often seen as very, very different, and people will tend to focus on one or the other. Personally, I find they fit together. Quantitative methods tend to tell me whether something's happens and how common it is to happen, whether it's something I'd expect to see in practice commonly. Qualitative methods, the ones which are more about asking people open-ended questions, either to both tell me new things that I didn't think about before, but also give me the why answers, if I'm trying to understand why it is I'm seeing a phenomenon. So the qualitative things, the measurements say, yeah, there's something happening, people are finding this feature difficult. The qualitative thing helps me understand what it is about it that's difficult and helps me to solve it. So I find they give you complementary things, they work together. The other thing you have to think about when choosing methods is about what's appropriate for the particular situation. And these things don't always work. Sometimes you can't do an in-the-wild experiment. If it's about, for instance, systems for people in outer space, you're going to have to do it in a laboratory. You're not going to go up there and experiment while people are flying around the planet. So sometimes you can't do one thing or the other. It doesn't make sense. Similarly with users, if you're designing something for chief executives of Fortune 100 companies, you're not going to get 20 of them in a room and do a user study with them. That's not practical. So you have to understand what's practical, what's reasonable, and choose your methods accordingly. Key to all of this is, I think, understanding the purpose of your experimentation. Why are you doing the evaluation in the first place? What do you want to get out of it? And there's usually said to be two main kinds of user evaluation. The first of them is what's called formative evaluation. And that's about how can I make something better? So you've designed an interface and you're partway through. This is in the iterative process. You're in that iterative process and you're thinking, okay, how do I make it better? How do I find out what's wrong with it? In fact, people often focus on what's wrong. The making it better sometimes is a better way to think about it. But very often people look for usability faults or flaws. Maybe you should be looking for usability opportunities. But whichever way, your aim is about making this thing better that you have in front of you. So that's about improving the design. The other kind of evaluation you might do is towards the end of that process, which is it good enough? Does it meet some criteria? Perhaps somebody's giving you something that says, you know, I've got to put this into the company and everybody has got to be able to use this within 10 minutes, otherwise it's no good. So you have some sort of criteria you're trying to reach. So that's more about contractual or sales obligations, and it's an end point thing. The two of these will often use very similar methods. You might measure people's performances to a whole range of things, but in the first of them, the formative one, your aim is about improving things. It's about unpacking what's wrong to make it better. In the second, your aim is about finding out whether you've done it well enough. Sometimes people use this to try and prove that they've done it well enough. So there's an interesting tension that goes on there. However, those two are important, but there's a third which is often missed, which is in practice people are doing things but often forget and don't realize sort of what they're doing. And call this, there isn't a good name for this one. I sometimes call it explorative, investigative, exploratory. And this is about when you want to understand something. So I might be giving somebody a new mobile interface to use because that's the interface I'm going to deliver and I want to make it better. But I might give them the interface to use because I want to understand how they would use something in life. So say it's a life logging application, it's about health monitoring. You know, how well are you feeling today and stuff like that. I might be more interested in finding out how that would go into their lives, how it would fit with their lives, how it would make sense to them, the kinds of things they would want to log. Later on then I might throw away completely what I've designed. So it wasn't an early design, it was more an exploratory thing, a thing to find out. Now you'll certainly do that from an academic research point of view, if you're doing a PhD or if you're doing research in HSI, but it was also true early in a design process. Your aim is more to understand the situation than it is to say, to make something that's going to get better or to say it's good enough. It's very easy to confuse these goals. That's why I'm telling you about them, because your goal, what you're really after, might be investigative, but you might address your experiment as if it's summative. A good enough answer. Yes, it was good enough. That doesn't tell you anything. So if I had this health application and I found people enjoyed using it, what does that tell me? What have I learned? So if you can if you know what you're trying to address, you can then tune your evaluation for that. And when does this process end? Evaluation could go on forever, especially if you think about these iterative processes. And that's not true. The summative one is when you do get to the end. But in these formative values, when do you get to the end of that? Now, there would have been times when you said, well, it's when we deliver the product, when it goes into shrink wrap and we put it on shelves. Nowadays, you may have heard the term perpetual beta, the idea that with web applications, you're constantly putting them up there, tweaking them, making them better, experimenting effectively, often with real users. So in some sense, real use is the ultimate evaluation. Because of that, actually, as you design, one of the things you might want to think about is how you are going to get that information from use in order to help you design. In fact, last week at the Wave Classic, the surf event, I've been involved in designing a local history application for the island I'm on. And we were able just in time to get a version of this out for the Wave Classic. And I know, because the number of downloads and access to feeds from logs, that some people were using the application, but I don't know whether they used any of the history things or they just used some of the other facilities on it, because that was a bit last minute, didn't get a chance to get the logging in. So I'm getting real use, but I wasn't getting information to help improve the future one. So certainly for future prototypes, we will actually have this in, but when you design, you can actually think about how you're going to gather information from real use to help you improve things.